It was good. The movie's good. There's a lot of good movies out there. Have you noticed that?
It suddenly got good after a really bad first 6, 8 months of the year.
Yeah.
A lot of good
Well, Winter's
movies.
Bone was in the summer, wasn't it?
Yes, they did
That one
release that
snuck
in the
in, and I
summer.
was like, this is awesome.
Yeah.
No one's in. Yeah, it's the same thing happens every year. Everyone waits with all their, like,
Yeah.
with they mistake kind of, I don't know what, like anything serious or for adults or whatever, for
Yeah.
like, well, no, that, if you have that, it has to come out, you know, in, for
Yeah.
2 weeks in December or whatever. And it's true, you don't get to see the more thoughtful movies
Yeah.
until the end. And then you're like, it's impossible to watch them all. Because you're like, you know, running
Yeah.
around scrambling.
But the talent, I think, also creates that in some ways. I mean, I think directors and producers, you know, they feel like if their movie's going to be in the race, it has to be in the fall. So they kind of don't want to be released in March or April.
Maybe. I don't know. I mean, I don't, if that's the case, those are like, you know, subtle things that you never hear people say. I mean, it's, I mean, maybe they do and I just don't hear them, but it, I think it's like a chicken and the egg thing, you know, something starts to happen and then everyone goes, okay, this kind of movie comes out on President's Day. These kind of movies come on Valentine's Day. That's what works there. This is the date that oftentimes they'll fixate on like dates that other movies worked really well on. And they go, well, that kind of movie must work well
Yeah.
on April 8th or whatever. It's a strange and inexact science
Yeah.
at best to releasing movies, but I think I don't know. I would personally like to have really good movies come out all year, but it's easier
Yes.
said than done, I guess.
It'd be nice.
It's hard to do. I mean, I really stand in tremendous awe of all these. Oh, so many good filmmakers. You know, Fincher. You know, True Grit's gonna be great.
Yeah. Looking forward to that.
Yeah, it's there's a lot of stuff to like this year, I think.
So, did you separate the business notion of all these other things and the artistic notion? Are they different things to you, or is it all big?
I don't know. I mean, obviously, everyone's aware to a certain extent of, because part of it is of the realities of, you know, you got to show it to an audience eventually. And so the audience, to a certain extent, when you're on stage, you're doing a play, you can feel an audience, their feedback, what's working, where it's going. And you do it in a bit of a vacuum, making movies. So you have to sort of anticipate as a director where the audience is going to be, what they're going to think. And I guess in a larger sense, you hear that noise about, well, you know, we'll maybe put it here, we'll maybe put it there. For me, I didn't necessarily think about the business side of it with this movie because I kind of, my goal was pretty clear and I worried about just sort of trying to make it work on my own. And if I could make it work on my own, well, I hoped it would work, but I had to have my own criteria for it. And it was about taking a you know, a heist story and trying to, you know, wrap that around. Or how use that to bring people into a movie that was about a drama, basically, about themes that I was really interested in, about children who pay for the sins of their parents, about how difficult it is to really change one's life, about redemption, about you know, the way our environments really shape us more than we kind of know. And so that, like, trying to do both of those and fold those together felt like a real challenge. And you know, I was benefited by the fact that the heist aspect of it, the was really specific. It wasn't like a generic, you know, sort of they people rob people. It had to do with this one neighborhood and this one city, and it was done a certain way, and I could do research and kind of get into it that way. And then I hope that if I was, you know, did my best with the movie, that it would work. I think you really get into a problem. So I try not to read too much of anything about like a movie that I'm working on or myself or any of that stuff. I think it just gets you into a bad place, which is you start thinking about like what people will say versus what you're actually doing. You know, and you know, there's history is full of examples of like movies that were thought they were going to be one way and turned out to be another. And if the filmmaker listened to some of that feedback, it might corrupt their process. And for me, I'm just I can only focus on so much, you
Well, you've
know.
made both of your movies fairly quietly. They weren't, you know, big, come look at me, come to the set every day and let's do ET stories.
Yeah, I don't like anything that's done on the set because I feel like once you show what's happening kind of behind the scenes, that actually sort of makes it look fake and cheap in a way. And it kind of, so I've never been somebody who's interested in that. And I definitely have want to do things without fanfare. Naturally, lower expectations are good because, you know, you can sort of sneak up in the marketplace or if they're not paying too much attention to it, it can be nice to be surprised by something and go, oh, I haven't heard about that. The trick is to both have that and also have somebody who's really going to get the movie out there when the time comes. And you know, Warner's Sue Kroll did an amazing job with that, and I really attribute the extent to the movie was that the movie was successful to those guys
Would you feel
and
like
their.
that on this particular picture? I mean, it did between doing the mask you know, outdoor, and which seemed to be kind of telling women not to watch the movie, which was odd. And then, but then it became very quickly the movie adults had to see.
I think that, you know, I don't, because those guys are really, I feel like I should focus on what I think I know about, and I definitely am willing to. I think as a director, it's a really good skill to, when, you know, Robert Elswood says, "I really like this frame," you go, "All right, well, let's try that frame. I'm not going to jerk it over 2 feet to the left." Or you know, and the same can be said for, you know, the actors and a lot of the great crew that I had in this movie. By the same token, you know, they said, "Look, this is how we think we can release the movie. We think it'd be successful. We think we can sell it as a, you know, a crime movie, and also, you know, tell people, give indications that there's more to it than that."
Mm-hmm.
And so I said, you know, okay. And I didn't get into getting on the phone and going, why is it this way? Why is it that way? Maybe I didn't want to be a cliche. I don't know. I'm sure every filmmaker is like on the phone. But, you know, they were so obviously behind it that it felt good. And, you know, it felt like, okay, well, we'll see what they can do, you know.
Do you have a consciousness, or did you have a consciousness of Ben Affleck, whatever the in parens version of you is? Or you even think about that anymore?
I think about it very little now. I don't think there's too much of a, I don't know, maybe I'm obtuse about it, but I don't think there's too much of a thing about me now. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. I sort of do my own thing. I'm not a very, very boring life. You know, I make not very many movies, and they tend to be the kind of movies that don't wind me up in the sort of crosshairs of all that stuff. That being said, you know, I'm certainly kind of familiar with the, obviously having lived through the arc of my own life.
Mm-hmm.
It's been interesting, and it's been, you know, I've gotten to see all different sides of the business, the good and the bad. And I think it's really been good and helpful to me to be able to just find consistency and focus now and understand that, like, it's about how hard I work. It's about how well I work. It's about the people that I work with. And focusing on that and not being distracted. I think one of the real challenges, you come in, you get successful in this business, and there's so many distractions and so much stuff going on, it's hard to distill. Well, what's important? What should I listen to? Who should I listen to? How do you make a movie work? Everybody sort of, you know, if you become a little bit of a, if you become the tonic that people need to drop in their, you know, situation that will make a movie get made, then everybody sort of wants you. And that can be really confusing. And so having kind of gotten to a place where it's, you know, I can work, it's still low key, and I really understand my kind of priorities, and I don't do much else outside of my family. I feel pretty lucky to have gotten to that place, you know, at the age that I am now. And I really...
At a young age. It's a pretty young age.
Yeah, right? I mean,
to go through all that.
Yeah, it's, I definitely, you know... I definitely went through a lot in 10 years, 12 years, and I think, and to still be, like I say, my mid to late 30s, you know, I'm really, really happy. I'm lucky to be here. I wouldn't change any of the kind of positive or negative experiences, because I wouldn't want a chance with winding up in a different place.
Right.
And I, you know, get to... I really have found an appreciation for being able to work in this business.
Mm-hmm.
I appreciate... people who work with me. I appreciate getting the opportunity from a studio to say, okay, you can spend X amount of our money.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I'm not one of these guys who goes, well, why isn't it 50% more? Or why don't you change this or that? I feel, you know, fortunate, and I know that the thing I need to be worried about is my own work. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And like what I have to bring to it, and making sure that that's as good as it can be. And it's a good thing to appreciate that stuff. And in the beginning, it's those are very hard things to get straight.
Right. So obviously in the beginning, early on, you and Matt had a little success writing. You got your Oscar. But do you did you think of yourself as a director then? Did you think of directing as a possibility then?
You know, we talked about, I wanted to, you know, advocated like, well, maybe we should co-direct the movie.
Mm-hmm.
Or maybe I'll direct the movie because you have the lead. And and ultimately it was clear that we wouldn't have been able to do it successfully. You know, I had directed like two student films.
Mm-hmm.
You know, horrendous. And
so they're not going to be the DVD extras on the
they're
town.
They're really not going to be. I paid to like buy them all back. And you know, but it was, we both had the sense that that was something that we wanted to do ultimately. We both wanted to be actors, you know, more than anything else. And then that sort of, the opportunities that we had kind of took over.
Mm-hmm.
And for me, I got to a place where I was like, I want to change the what I'm doing. I really want to start directing. I want to have a broader sense of authorship. I want to try this side of myself out. And Matt's just been so I mean, she's been so busy with the greatest directors in the world. Yeah. So, you know, Matt will one day be in... I think Matt is an excellent director who just hasn't directed his first movie yet. And when he if he finally gets a break, I think, you know...
Well, it feels like you kind of went faster and he kind of got luckier. Like, somehow not going... Yeah. Shooting up as fast as an actor gave him room.
It's interesting,
or something.
Yeah. I mean, Matt has had tremendous opportunities to work with the best directors in the world, I think. You know, from Spielberg, Scorsese, you know, Redford, Coppola, Gus.
Married to Eastwood.
Eastwood. I mean, just how about the Coens? Yeah. How about that list right there? And there's a bunch of other really talented guys on there, Greengrass and so on. And, you know, those, I think, you know, that tends to define him. I obviously would have done the same thing, you know. And, you know, any two careers are sort of different in, by nature of chance and by nature of the opportunity that you have, among other things. But, you know, I think we're actually, you know, both pretty, in a strange way, still sort of, we still connect, we still talk about the material we're doing. I still, you know... So we still feel very much the same with Matt, you know, which is a nice thing. And my brother, really, this, the three of us gone through this. And to have friends and peers who you can talk about your stuff with. We don't get, it's not so much about, like, whose career is where. It's more about, like, sort of what we're doing. And it's a really nice thing. It's a luxury to have. And these guys, both of them have been really, you know, really into the town and, you know. It's fun. Obviously, Gone Baby Gone.
And Sean Bailey's not in a bad spot for you guys either.
Sean Bailey, it panned out for Sean,
Yeah.
I was telling him he couldn't, he was producing another movie, and there was some talk of bringing him on to do The Town, and he couldn't do it, you know, Tron and all this other stuff. And for a while, I was like, oh, man, I used to guilt trip him all the time. I can't believe you didn't do the movie, you know, and I can't do that anymore. I'm like... Turned out not to be a career mistake for you. Turned out to be a smart move.
We'll give you the next $40 million.
Yeah, exactly.
So where do you start now? Where do you, you know, after all this, you've made Gone Baby Gone, a great acclaimed movie, did good box office. All these people kind of emerged from it, which was, I guess, thrilling for you as also, I would think. So then you have to do the next thing. Where do you? What is the germ that starts you off?
Yeah, I mean, I'm really, like you say, I think... There's two things. One is like the sort of ideas, the original ideas I have, which take a longer time to gestate and form. Mm-hmm. And in the meantime, you know, I'm lucky to be able to, you know, get on the director hierarchy. You know, I mean, there's plenty of guys ahead of me, but I do, man. You know, if something good kind of falls off one of those guys' table, I would do that too. I don't have a. formula for okay, I'm gonna go do it's gonna be a you know a $60 million science fiction movie with a female lead, you know it's more about like for me what it always has been is about good story and working with good people and it's a piece of material that looks like an attractive good cast is always gonna be exciting to me. First two movies, I think the thing I loved about them the most was that was the cast, you know, and I guess the other thing is you know just finding something that. I can connect to that means something to me. Like, and that could be a $150 million movie. Like, I mean, I don't know, Blade Runner, for example, is a spectacular movie that is as powerful and deep in terms of the themes it's dealing with as any low budget Sundance movie has been, or any French movie or any movie at all that I've ever seen. And by the same token, you can find some excellence in a smaller movie about, you know, about a kid trying to bail out her father. So, it's really about, you know, people's like what's finding something good.
So you're developing all the time, or are you?
I have a couple of things that I'm developing. I'm not a, I haven't like amassed a bunch of stuff. There's a couple of things that are people are writing, and one is The Trade, which is this movie about Kekich and Peterson who kind of swapped families. They played for the Yankees, and my brother's working on that with me. Although now he's doing this movie, so I think that's going to cut into his time a little bit, his writing time. And there's a couple other things that are sort of out there, and it's tricky. It's hard to know. You know, I also understand now that you get these opportunities are really important, and you have to be really thoughtful. And that there's, you know, it's a privilege to get a chance to direct a movie because you get a lot of people to work with you, and you know, you're committing resources to somebody's, and so you better make the right choice and work really hard.
So, what's the first thing you connected with on The Town?
I think the idea of how...
functionally, what was the first...
Oh, the
role. Did somebody send you a script?
I thought it was a great part to play. When I got that, I was like, I never get a chance to play a part this good. I want to do this part.
So they came to you as an actor first.
They came to me, they sent me the script. What do you think? Mm-hmm. Do you like this? And I said, I like it. I want to play the part. They said, well, what about directing it too? And I said, nah, I'm going to get pigeonholed as Boston crime movie director mm-hmm. guy. I want to, you know, what about just playing the role? We find a director. And so they were like, okay, well, we're amenable to that. But what happened was the momentum sort of slowed down. And I was mm-hmm. like, what about so-and-so? Oh, so-and-so's not there. You know, trying to get a director on a movie right. is a big ordeal. Mm-hmm. And ultimately, I realized that if I was going to get it made and do it, I had to take responsibility for it. I had to rewrite it. I had to do it. I had to mm-hmm. direct it. And I had to push it out there and get it made and you know, put it all on myself and take the risk, you know, and not hedge. And
so from your position of status, you already kind of have a producer's role when they come to you as an actor.
Yeah.
You're involved with getting that director or trying to put together the project.
Yeah, I mean, definitely have. Yeah, for sure. In this case, I did because... Yeah. You know, I mean, Graham was on the movie, but naturally, but there's, you know, in terms of trying to like put it all together, mm-hmm. Okay, write and direct, and how am I going to assemble this and cast and deal with the studio? Sure. There's some aspect of it, but again, you know, Graham and Basil were both quite smart and very helpful. But once I sort of took on the idea that, okay, I'm going to do it, mm-hmm. Then I just sort of rewrote it and came back to them and said, here's the budget I need, here's what I need, you know, I need mm-hmm. to, from you guys, tell me what you need from me. Mm-hmm. It was a really short conversation, you know. You can cast, you know, you can cast the best actors, you know, we want to we'll look at it and mm-hmm. go over it with you, but basically we'll back that idea at this number.
Right.
It's got the genre stuff, the heist stuff has to work. Mm-hmm. You have to kind of deliver on that. They made right. no bones about it, and I nodded my head with a lot of conviction in the room and then left, like, oh, what am I going to do? I'm going to do this.
Do you think like that? I mean, do you think about things crashing into each other and how you're going to do that? I mean,
I think to me what made that stuff interesting is the is that like I've done movies, a bunch of movies where things crash into yeah. each other, so boring. But when it's been good and interesting, it's been about mm-hmm. the characters. It's not about the people. Right. So my whole philosophy going in was like I want the audience to care about the people and feel that the movie is very realistic, mm-hmm. so that when they get in a car and they're driving 60 or 70 miles an hour down a very narrow street,
right.
you'll feel nervous. And it's like what made this French Connection work. And it was Hackman pounding on the dashboard mm-hmm. that you identify with. You know yeah. that guy, Papa Doyle, you care about him and you're with him. And mm-hmm. he's what anchors you there, not screeching tires.
Right.
And so that was at least what I told myself to assuage my fear about what was going to work. And we had a lot of other ideas. I thought it'd be interesting to do. I wanted to do a car chase a bit like the feel of the one in Amores Perros, mm-hmm. where it felt like it was really happening. You were for sure mm-hmm. it was like happening on the streets in Mexico City. And, mm-hmm. You know, so we shot car to car, you know, a lot of stuff. Because the guys had masks, we could shoot over stuntmen onto the cop mm-hmm. in the other car. So having that connecting them, mm-hmm. I think made it feel more realistic. We put these sparrow cams like under the front of the car, so you get that like sense of the walls going by, that sort mm-hmm. of Rabbit Warren feel of it. And, you know, it was also based on this research that I did about a couple of real bank robbery heists, armed truck heists, mm-hmm. And one of them was in the North End. So that was a new set piece, and so was the one at the beginning. Mm-hmm. And there was definitely a challenge about that. There was definitely something that made me, I was the most scared of that, of anything, because I hadn't done it. Mm-hmm. And I knew that if it was bad, not only would I disappoint the audience, but I'd disappoint the studio, you know, because they expected that to work, and I had behaved so confidently about how it would.
So do you say to yourself at that point, okay, I got to go get, you know, Bourne's AD or somebody who's done that? Or are you just like, I'm going to figure this out myself? And
You on the one hand, you rely, Gary Himes did the car mm-hmm. stuff, like the drivers, mm-hmm. the stunts, the smash. I mean, the guy's amazing. You just can't do it without
right.
people who know how to do that. It can't be done. No matter who you are, you're not in the car driving. And he was extraordinary. Alex Witt, Robert Ellswit, Dylan Titchener and Chris Rouse. I mean, those guys and the locations guys, but those guys really were the core of, mm-hmm. of people who had obviously had expertise. And we did some digital stuff, very little. I mean, what it comes down to is you saying, this is what I want to have happen. This is mm-hmm. the way I think it should happen. This is the way I want to execute it. And you hire people that you believe could execute it really well. And mm-hmm. I got lucky. I mean, I did. It's a lot like acting. Here's the story. Mm-hmm. Here's kind of what the people say. Here's right. what I believe is happening subtextually. Mm-hmm. Go. And then, you know, you have Jeremy Renner, it looks great, you're a genius. And if you mm-hmm. don't, it can be terrible. So at the end of the day, you have to sort of let it go, and you're relying on the people that are doing it.
So there was no argument about how you're going to cast the movie, you said, going in, no, I want actors, not stars, and that's my priority.
I mean, you know, I think it was like, I wasn't even, you know, What's that? It's like the line in The Player where the guy's like, no stars. This movie's too big for stars. He ends up with like all the stars. It wasn't that so much as I knew that at the budget that we were going to be at. Right. I wanted the best actors. There's great actors who are stars and great actors who are not. The budget that we were at was, our cap was prohibitive in terms of we couldn't pay anybody's retail fee or even wholesale fee, you know? And so I understood that. At the same time, I said, well, that means that we're going to cast a broader net in terms of who we can go to. And I was excited by that. And they were open to it. And they liked the idea of, you know, kind of new faces or up-and-coming faces, you know, that they embraced that, you know? And so when it was like, it's Blake or it's Rebecca or it's, you know, even Hurt Locker hadn't come out. I mean, it was Jeremy. All that stuff, you know, in aggregate, it started to feel kind of, I think it worked as a plus for us because it made the movie feel more new. It wasn't like, okay, even the greatest actors, you see them and you know, all right, I've seen 10 of their movies. This is sort of how it's going to progress. And having people, it's what my brother did for Gone Baby Gone so well, I think, is besides just being a great actor, you hadn't seen movies with him. You didn't know what was going to happen. He could get killed halfway through. He could turn out to be the villain. He could be, you know, you had no association with a Casey Affleck movie, particularly as a protagonist.
Right.
It seemed unusual. And so it kind of kept the audience more engaged, I think, on the wire as it went down. And with all these guys, like Rebecca, you know, putting her in a bank, she's winsome, she's beautiful, she's lovely, all that stuff. But I wanted to feel like she was almost picked at random. If it's, you know, a superstar X, you know, as soon as you see them in the bank, you know the story of the movie.
Law and Order episode.
Right, exactly. It corrupts it, you know. And so we had somebody who's as gifted as her, but also somebody who felt like that it was, where you felt it was organic when she was sort of pulled into the movie in this hostage situation.
So how did you land on her? Was that after Vicky Cristina? Was it?
I saw Vicky Cristina and I loved it. And I really loved it. And I thought, I loved her. And I just called her agent and was like, listen, I really like her. You know, would she meet with me? She's enough to read, obviously. She's a great actress, but can I just sit down with her and talk to her for like 20 minutes and called Warner Brothers and was like, do you know who Rebecca Hall is? I think she'd be great for me. And they're like, yeah, we love her. She's great.
Wow.
And it was just like that. You know, I couldn't. I felt like, you know, I felt like I was being punked.
and Jeremy.
And Renner, yeah. Renner came in, sat down with him. I knew him from Jesse James. They did with Casey.
Mm-hmm.
And that was a bit more like, you know, they want to go sort of go through the paces a bit. But, you know, they ultimately were like, this is clearly, this guy is going to, you know, amaze people. They were his biggest supporters. And and so that was a hard part. I sort of looked around and couldn't, because I didn't want somebody super famous. And I wanted somebody who could, it's hard to play tough. You know what I mean? It's a weird thing. It's like, it's something that comes through your skin. It's not it's not the way you say a word.
Right.
And to have that sort of coiled spring thing, the kind of, the epitome of that, I guess, is the Pesci character in Goodfellas, you know? Renner had the ability to do that convincingly. Mm-hmm. And it was such a tricky thing to do because that part could have turned into a cliche
at the drop of a
hat, you know? All right, he's the wild card. I mean, every ensemble movie has a guy who's the wild card. is going to get them all caught or whatever. Mm-hmm. And, you know, with Jeremy doing it, it was like, it felt like extraordinary to me, like a great drama. It was wonderful. He was just so, watching him, putting him in a scene, it was like, even the first couple of days, I sat him down, it was like the feeling I had with Ed Harris and Gone Baby Gone.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, okay, well, I know I always have something to cut to. You know what I mean? Something's not working. I just go back to Jeremy, looking at his napkin, you know, and they'll forget that we're in the wrong looks or a different room, other wardrobe or a bad performance, loop something over his face, and, you know, he can have a great performance, helps you get away with a lot of stuff as a filmmaker.
And Postlethwaite was kind of a surprise. It's fun to see him work. You know, he doesn't work as much anymore, and he kind of became a little bit of a cliche, and now he's doing something very different in this movie.
Yeah, Pete was, the fact that he wasn't as, you know, ubiquitous and hadn't kind of been around, he had done like a day on Inception, and they said his name wasn't a thing on a list that the Laura Kennedy sent me, who was the cast director, was great, and I was like, gosh, Pete Postlethwaite. And they emailed me his, like, he didn't audition, but he like sat down and chatted with Chris and they videoed it. So they have like little videos of actors kind of like, well, how they look now, what they're up to, that sort of stuff. And I was transfixed by Pete. He had gotten a little older and a little more charactery. And he was really kind of thin, but also I thought, God, that could be more scary than trying to get a tough guy, you know? Somebody where you think, well, the malice, the danger must be in his soul, you know, not his body.
Bill Hickey and Percy's Honor.
Right. Exactly. So I sent him the script, and he was like, you know, it wasn't in the schedule and this and that. And I kept sending it to him. Finally, I was like, I wrote him a letter. I was like, Pete, you have to do this. Mm-hmm. It's a few days. You know, you're going to be great. Please. And he did it. I literally talked him into it, which I didn't think really happened, you know, that you could actor somebody into doing a part. And he came, and I, like, you know, tried to do everything to make it good for him. I was really nervous, like, Pete's coming, you know. And at the end of the 2 days, he was like, I'm glad I, you know, you stuck with it and you stayed on me. I was like, ah, oh, the best thing he could have said. He thanked me for being a pain in his ass.
And yourself, was that, is that hard for you? Is that something that's challenging?
You know, directing yourself, it's like, as an actor, you know, I was happy to have a guy who was always on time, never argued with me. You know, it's rare that you have that kind of connection with the lead actor.
Well, do you argue with yourself? I mean, you're a writer on this, and the director, and the actor.
Not really. You know, it's like
confusion.
I get a kind of lack of surety at times, like, because I'm the only filter.
Right.
I'm going, well, hold on, is this working? Like, let me make sure this is going to play. You know, and that's one of the nice things about having the other actors that are talented. Mm-hmm. You know, you get in, you say the words with them, and you can all of a sudden something can feel when it rings hollow or clanks a bit. You go, okay, this is because of the material, or this is because of the choice as a director. Mm-hmm. You know, in terms of a connection with, you know, it does serve you, I think, to be your own leading man, just because you are on the same page and you're kind of a hand inside the movie, moving it around on camera. Mm-hmm. You know. And yeah, you get along. You're on the same page. I mean, you know, me and my brother, it cut out the 45 minutes I spent, you know, every morning with my brother talking to the scene in great detail. I could, you know, skip that part.
So it's not just that he was your brother and you had to deal with brotherly things. It was that he's just another actor.
Yeah, I was to both, deal with. I think. You know, he's your brother and he's an actor. I mean, you know, that process of, and all good actors, I think, are demanding on some level. I think that's got to be like a negative term, like, oh, he's difficult or he's demanding. Mm-hmm. You find that label's applied to most really good actors. It's because they care. Mm-hmm. They scrutinize stuff. And they get to a place and they go, no, we're not just going to get railroaded by, we're all going to do the scene because this is the scene and this is the set and this is, it doesn't work. It's not good. My brother is not as difficult as most, but he does, you know, like anybody good, he wants to know, well, why am I doing this? Well, where would this be? And how is this going to work? And, you know. And after a while, as a director, you're just like, there's a part of you that wants to go, just get the... with your brother, you can do that. With myself, I can do that. But
did you know he would be kind of this phenomenon? I mean, it was like Casey was always the other Affleck for a long time, and now he's become, you know, a real presence in the scene.
Casey's become his own actor of, like, known as an actor of great, great skill.
Yeah.
In his own right. It's always something that I knew and Matt knew and Aaron, who wrote this movie, the people that knew Casey and worked with him for years. It's a frustrating thing to know somebody's talented and just feel like, when are they going to get their break? And feel like you're the only person who kind of believes that. I'm sure it's even more frustrating if you are that person. And then, you know, I thought that I was going to be like, I'm going to show people how good my brother is. And of course, Jesse James came out first.
Right.
So it just looked like riding the Casey bandwagon, but that was fine. I mean, you know, I was just happy to see, A, that, you know, other people respect Casey, and B, that I wasn't crazy.
Yeah.
You know, and now he's, you know, he turns into, you know, really interesting performances. He's very judicious about what stuff he does, and I wish he would work a little bit more, but he's doing this movie now, and he did Killer Inside Me, which was a really intense performance, and his movie that he directed, I thought was spectacular. And that took a lot of time out of his life to direct that movie.
I think he was trying to prove he was crazy again.
Yeah, exactly. and I think it's a really good movie and a great performance from Joaquin.
So how do you make that decision for yourself at this point, whether you want to get behind the camera or in front of the camera?
You know, it's I've learned that it's more important what you say no to than what you say yes to. And that to have patience. To not feel that thing of that you, as an actor, you feel like you start out, you never, you know, you can't get a job. And so it's like, I gotta work if I can find a job. And it's really counterintuitive to say it's more important to just say no. And I'm lucky because I can wait and, you know, as a director now, I can look at a couple of different scripts and take my time. I don't think I should be smart to wait forever, but I think it's because then you get too precious maybe.
Right.
But it's just about finding the right material. And, you know, as an actor, I've been super lucky. The last 5-6 years, I've gotten a chance to work with really great people, and I've gotten some scripts that I really, really liked. The you know, highest among those is the movie I'm doing now, with Malik, and that's like a master class in directing and in acting. And so, you know, I think it's wise to just, for me, to be patient and then, you know, work with, you know, those best, most talented people I can possibly find.
So do you watch what Terry's doing on the set as things are going? Part of your experience?
Yeah, I mean, one of the great, like, joys and privileges of it is to stand next to the guy while he makes his decisions and kind of eavesdrop on, like, what is he, you know, hear what he's doing. And we don't have a lot of setup times in that movie. It's not a lot. It moves really fast. So the actors are there the whole time. And so you just get to sort of be part of that flow. And I kind of feel like bringing a notebook, but I think it would be tacky. So, you know.
What's funny, has that reputation of being almost like a, you know, he's hiding in the corner somewhere. But he doesn't seem to be that way with anybody when he's working with him.
He's a lovely man. Yeah. And I think he just doesn't like publicity, which I can understand. Although he's never, I shouldn't speak for him because he's never said that to me one way or another. I've never asked him, why do you this or why do you that? I'm just happy to be like there, you know, doing the movie. But I can say that as a guy, he's a wonderful, warm guy, incredibly gifted. And it's just a treat working with him. So, you know. You'll have to figure out your relationship with him when Tree of Life comes out.
Yes. Well, does you feel like you're using a different muscle group when you go back to just acting, quote unquote?
You know what it feels like? It feels like I could have a chance to really learn. If I'm working with somebody like Terry, I can learn an enormous amount because I have have the right glasses on. You know, having done the experience a couple of times, I know sort of what to look for, what to listen to more. And yeah, and other than that, you're kind of responsible for just the silo of your own performance.
Right.
So there's a bit of a relief because you don't have to worry about anything else. You're directing, every problem is your problem. Mm-hmm. When you're acting, it's just your character is the only thing that's your problem and what you're doing. And it's an interesting, it is a different muscle group because it's like, it's a narrower but deeper sort of laser of focus, you know, the minutia of your character, what their life is like, what they've done in their life, how they feel. And it's much more self-absorbed exercise, you know, as an actor, because you need to be focused on yourself and obviously listen to the other actors, but it's about the recreation of the self. And directing is just all about like listening to people all day long and trying to stave off disaster. And
so you're a better actor for having directed?
For sure. I learned better actor, better writer. I would encourage anybody, especially now that you can make a movie, you know, basically with a video camera.
Right.
Anybody who's an actor, to try to direct something, at least a short or something. It really gives you a good perspective on acting and writing and storytelling and what works. And it's been extremely helpful for me.
And as a director, what is your relationship with your movies, particularly this one? But I mean, are you done when the cutting room's done and then everything belongs to the studio and what they're going to do with it and awards or something else to worry about? Or
I think to me, it's like, as an actor, you definitely, I've set sort of parameters more and more on, I'm willing to do this much talking about the movie.
Right.
Because I don't think it's good for me and I don't think it's good necessarily for the illusion of the movie. You have responsibility to do set amount for sure,
right.
But I think it's smart to keep to that. As a director, you know, and writer and actor, and somebody who's made a lot of promises about what they were going to do with the movie and how it's going to work, and somebody who believes in sticking to their word, it's very hard to say no to anything. You just feel like, okay, I got to be there. If someone wants to talk about this movie, it's my responsibility to be there to talk to them. So here I am, and I'll continue to do that, and I'm going to go to Asia in January, and I've been to Europe and twice, and because I feel that I owe it to the people who believed in me, and I'm really grateful because not everyone believed in me, and also I'm really, you know, careerist level because, you know, it'll help me make the argument to get a better budget next time.
Well, I mean, for your emotionally though, in terms of the movies, do you let go or do you hang on for?
I let go at when I get to a point where there's like a catharsis that's happened for me both times because it's so exhausting and so all-consuming because I get insecure about the movie and so I decide that I have to just, you know, like the Larry Bird thing, like shoot free throws for 18 hours out of neuroses or I don't know, whatever it is. And I know that it works in terms of making the movie better, but it makes the process really hard on me. And at the end of it, there's definitely like a letting go, a kind of, you know, we did the master print, the print master rather. Mm-hmm. It was a sort of like sense of, it's finished. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like at this point, there's the movie, it's what it is, it's not going to change anymore. Even, you know, extended cut DVD, director's cut DVD, I'm sure there'll be 10 iterations of the DVD.
Yes.
But that at that moment, I kind of let it go. And you have mm-hmm. to, you have to have your own standard for what constitutes success, what constitutes failure, and, mm-hmm. you know, try to meet those standards. And then it has to be just up to the gods. Like, I hope people like it. I hope they mm-hmm. go. You know, I can go to sleep knowing I kind of left it all out there.
Something you also learned as an actor, or is that something that's been part of the directorial
premise? I work harder as an actor as a result of being a director, just a result of the fact that, like, I found that when I didn't have any ideas and when I didn't know what to do, when I didn't know what to make it better, you know, interviewing more people, taking the pass at the right, you know, like would throw off results, and that would get me out of jams. And so I just started dedicating myself in that way. And it's time consuming, but it works. You know, I went and did a month in Oklahoma before I shot this, started shooting this movie, just mm-hmm. out of that same, like, because I feel like you should prepare a role as an actor the way you prepare a movie as a director. I think that's, when preparing as a director, I found that it was doing all the work that you really should do as an actor, and that you find reasons not to, you know, because of schedule or another movie, your family, or whatever. And so with this, I thought, you know, I'm going to prepare as if I were directing the movie and get that deep in it.
But when something like Julie happens, and there's this overwhelmingly negative response that really has very little to do with the movie in reality. I mean, that movie did not deserve, no movie really has ever deserved the kind of shit that got. You just go, okay, I'm not going to have that relationship with what happens down the road again, or?
You know, I was really aware of what that was and what it was about. You know, like, as you say, that was a negative reaction to a surfeit of tabloid publicity, not only about me, but that I happened to be there at the time when a lot of these outlets were expanding. There was only like two magazines at the time.
Right.
And right when that story hit, like a bunch of other magazines started business, and they realized there was more demand for this product, which we now see is, by modern standards, insane. That story seems like quaint and tiny, you know? So there was this huge proliferation, and it kind of felt like, oh, it's all about, you know, these guys. And, you know, I mean, planes that crash sell, not planes that land. And so,
though I think the film got overly, even by critics.
Nobody saw that movie.
People were busy, because there was interesting stuff in there that they didn't even bother talking about. It was like,
look, Marty Brest directed that movie. He's a really good director. I learned a ton from Marty Brest. You know, Midnight Run, Beverly Hills Cop. You know, he's an extraordinary guy. That movie and that result was about the tabloids and that and the tabloid world, and it points to our danger, which is letting that stuff inform your life, because it really can bleed over onto the movies, into the kind of illusion you're trying to create, and to the way you're trying to get audiences kind of committed and to suspending their disbelief. You know, there's part of people that are always going to view movies as horse racing. So even if they don't know the horse or see the race, they want to open up the paper and see where, you know, if it came in first or it came in last.
Right.
Which is why you get more drama out of movies that succeed and movies that fail. You know, at the end of the day, mostly it's entertainment. Occasionally it's a work of art. You know, I look forward to seeing Beautiful because I think it'll be an art movie, like a true work of art. But, you know, it doesn't, we have a habit of sort of liking to mine the drama of it for a while. And one of the things that happens too is with the actors is that we come to associate actors more with their personal lives than with the movies they do. And the movies tend to just be like kind of interstitial commercial breaks in the soap opera. And it's too bad because it makes it hard to watch the actors work.
And it doesn't seem to sell movies. That's the funny thing. Is the most famous people don't seem to...
That whole thing is actually not based around like admiration or interest as an artist. It's like a schadenfreude. It's a sort of wish fulfillment. And I don't know what it is, but it's not good.
So and this movie actually got the benefit of that on some level, because there was the drops are small and the audiences are finding it, and there was there was a sense of the wave, but I think it was because people liked the movie, genuinely liked the movie.
I hope so. I mean, I was just happy. I wasn't you know, I mean, I never expected the movie to be. I was hoping, you know, to just kind of break even studio and say, hey, you guys didn't lose money, you know. I mean, honest to God, that is not bullshit. It's not false. I mean, it was really. Spending, $37 million on a movie to me is a lot of money. Mm-hmm. And it was a hard road to get back to. And it's an R-rated movie and drama and mm-hmm. all this stuff. And all of a sudden I'm thinking, when you're making the movie, you're an artist. And when you're releasing it, all of a sudden, you start thinking about, like, God, I hope this movie's successful. I hope people mm-hmm. see it. Because it's just going to be a tree falling in the woods with you and all the, like, pretensions that you had 6 months ago. Mm-hmm. So I was really, really shocked that the movie, did as well as it did, which is not to say that it's the greatest towering success, but just that it, came along and made money is, it was a thrill for me. I really appreciated it and it mattered a lot. And I'm really quite grateful to every single person who bought a ticket.
So the Ben Affleck story is figure it out, get your head down, have a boring life, and go do your work.
Absolutely. There it is.
Excellent.
All right.